هيا على الفلاح.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه وبعد. My dearest listeners, we continue on the topic the social conduct of a Muslim. We were speaking about the rights of the husband and wife and the general etiquettes of the relationship, obviously, between the husband and wife and the children within the nuclear home. Let us understand that definitely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prescribed certain rights of the husband, certain rights of the wife. And we should also know that there are many, many books that are written in this regard, as we mentioned yesterday. We were reading from a book which was written by a Mawlana, Mawlana Musa Karmadi, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant him a long and healthy life, in London. And we had actually mentioned the points or the rights of a wife over her husband. And I'm sure many of the women must have had a nice day yesterday, because they must have been all day mentioning, you see, this is what you're supposed to be doing, you see, this is what you're supposed to be doing, you see, this is what you're not supposed to be doing, etc. So today we have to balance the scale, and we are now going to mention today the rights of the husband over his wife, which means this is what the wife has to do. I will once again read from the same book, because I have actually found that the points that are mentioned in this particular book are very, very valid, they are very current, they are very necessary, and we need to go through them, we need to understand them. I do know that we probably have heard a lot in many other programs, as well as we may have read a lot of books, etc. But let us try to understand that the cornerstone of the society of a Muslim community is the nuclear family, the husband, the wife, and the children. And this is where we need to start. This is why we are going to speak about this. And inshallah, we will move further on, and we will, as I had mentioned in the introductory session, that inshallah we will move very, very far regarding the social conduct of a Muslim. So, reading from this particular book, The Rights of the Husband, the author says, in the same way that a woman has rights over her husband, Islam has laid down certain rights of the husband which his wife must fulfill, and guidelines which must be observed. The basic duties of a wife are as follows. He says, firstly, she must protect the wealth and property of her husband. She must not be destructive or abusive of the wealth and property in any way. She must abstain from unnecessary expenditure, extravagance, and wastage. She should spend only with the pleasure and permission of her husband. Being very demanding will strain the marriage at some point. And I repeat that. Being very demanding will strain the marriage at some point. On the other hand, by getting used to budgeting and economizing for everything, she will be able to maintain a happy and harmonious home. Subhanallah, that point speaks for itself. We need to understand it, and we need to understand that it comes from the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The second point, she must protect herself, her chastity and dignity, as well as that of her husband's, both in his presence and absence. Not only is being unfaithful unacceptable, but it will destroy the marriage. The next point, he says, she must never unnecessarily relate what goes on between herself and her husband to others. If it is a good relationship that is being mentioned to others, they may become jealous and create unnecessary problems. Subhanallah. Look at how broad Islam is. Look at how broad the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are. A person would probably think, you know, I'm getting along with my husband so much, let me actually mention it to other people. And here the author is telling you, you know what, Islamically, if you are going to mention it to other people, there is a possibility that people might become jealous and create unnecessary problems. So don't unnecessarily relate it to everyone that, you know, this is it and that's it. The author continues to say, even a person whom we may regard as a very close friend can easily let us down and spread rumors about us or create problems and tensions for us. Amazing. The question I have for you today is, which religion teaches this? I mean, let me read this statement again. Listen to it very carefully and ask yourselves, How fortunate are we to have someone who's actually mentioned this to us? We have it on the plate from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam's teachings, either directly or indirectly. He either has mentioned it or we have either learned from his life and the lives of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Listen to the point again. Even a person whom we may regard as a very close friend can easily let us down and spread rumors about us or create problems and tensions for us. Subhanallah. If it is a bad relationship that we are mentioning to others or difficulties we may be having, then we must understand that everyone is neither qualified to advise us nor is everyone genuine. So what the author is trying to say here is that we must understand that when we are mentioning some bad qualities and difficulties to some people, not all of them are qualified to advise us and not all of them are genuine. We may solve our problems, and people will still be spreading tales about how we do not get along. Subhanallah. Think about that again. The author is saying, you know, you might have a problem, and you've solved your problem, and you are getting on now very well. But because you confided in someone who did not have a genuine feeling for you, they are still spreading tales 2-3 years down the line how you and your husband are not getting along. And the reason why they are doing this is you gave them the opportunity to do that. You went to go and tell them that I'm having this problem and that problem. Even if you tell them later on that, you know, my problems are solved, they probably will still want to spread gossip about you because that is the job of a lot of people. May Allah not make us from amongst those who spread gossip. So the author says this will cause a greater problem. Many a time people give us the wrong advice knowingly or unknowingly, which plunges us into disaster, creates a major problem out of a minor issue, and does not help the situation in any way. This will not solve anything for us. We must only seek advice from those who are qualified to do so, experienced, and have a genuine feeling for us. I did mention this very briefly. The author then continues to say, she must abstain from nagging, from screaming, from shouting, from swearing, etc. She should not get annoyed at every small issue that occurs. Rather, she should try to understand that not everything will always happen the way she wants it to happen. She must carefully consider the likes and dislikes of her husband too. This is not an easy task, for at times it requires a lot of patience. This is how the marriage will grow and her value will increase in the home. She will be dearly missed if she leaves the home, even for a short time. On the other hand, if she always wants things to be done her way, always whinging about what she is supposed to have, then she will be regarded as a burden in the home rather than a blessing. The husband of such a woman will feel more comfortable outside his home than within the home. This can result in him spending more time with others. So sometimes when your husband is spending long hours outside the home, maybe you should ask yourselves, is it me who is causing this? Maybe the way I am talking to him, maybe I am nagging to him. So look at yourself. It might just be, we are not saying it is always the case, but what we are saying is it might just be that the problem lies with you, that you might be talking to him in a bad way. You might not be, you know, smiling at him. The husband comes in from a long day at work. Obviously, he's got a few tensions in his head, etc., etc. He needs someone to smile at him. You are not giving him the smile, so he'll probably go back out of the house as soon as he can. So you need to give him that smile, you need to ask him how are you doing, etc., talk to him. And as we mentioned yesterday, the husband in return also needs to communicate back with his wife. He needs to talk with her. He has been out all day. When he comes home, he can't just be silent and, you know, get buried in the newspaper and in the news, etc., etc., and not speak to his wife and his children. They need him. He has to talk to them. So this is what the author is saying. The author continues to say, one of the main reasons, and this is obviously a very important point also that a lot of us probably disregard, and sometimes we wouldn't even know that this is what Islam teaches. One of the main reasons why marriage has been prescribed is for a man to abstain from fulfilling his natural sexual desires in an incorrect place, but rather fulfill them with the woman who has been made his lawful wife and has become permissible for him. For this reason, the husband must be granted the opportunity of fulfilling his desires whenever he feels so. The wife must not unnecessarily refuse and she must not unnecessarily present lame excuses. Where does she expect him to fulfill this desire if she refuses? That's a question she needs to ask herself. Where does she expect him to fulfill this desire if she refuses? If she does so, she may be guilty of encouraging misconduct. So sometimes a woman might say, you know, I'm going to fix him, right? Now what does she expect him to do? So she might be guilty of encouraging him towards haram. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. The author continues to say, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has gone to the extent of explaining that even if a woman is busy cooking or doing something else and the husband calls her, it is her duty to actually respond and to go to see to the husband. A husband may desire, subhanallah, actually Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us so much, and he has actually taught us that, look, when the husband has a desire, obviously the wife must not present lame excuses. The same applies the other way around. Obviously, the men also need to consider the plight of their wives, and obviously they need to understand that it is against the Islamic teachings to unnecessarily abstain and to actually turn a blind eye. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to be steadfast. The next point he mentions, he says, it is detrimental to disrespect one's husband. Shouting, screaming, swearing, venting frustrations by throwing things around, or beating up the children, or breaking things in the house, and being sarcastic when spoken to are all unacceptable. Now I'm going to pause here for a moment.
Thank you so much for listening to this short message.